Well, here we are looking at the life of David. David, the glorious king and the sweet psalmist of Israel. We took a look at David briefly 2 weeks ago when we looked at Psalm 51, the psalm that he wrote after committing adultery and then after committing murder to try to cover up his adultery and then God exposing him. And then he writes Psalm 51 as a confession, as repentance before God, and as a prayer for personal revival. And really the summary of that story is that we are never too far away from personal revival. We have never blown it to the point that we are beyond personal revival. Personal revival is always one sincere, broken, repentant heart's cry away. And that is Psalm 51. And it requires faith to believe that. Here is a man who's covered with blood on his hands from murder. Imagine how his heart was telling him, it's over. It's over. Reminding him, nightmares reminding him of what he did. But yet he said, Lord, wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. That takes faith when everything feels so done and ruined. But yet God's word says that he makes all things new and that he will wash our sins and forget them. It takes faith for you to feel a certain way, put yourself in David's shoes, yet to have the faith to say, if you wash me, I will be whiter than snow. David's faith. David was a man after God's own heart, not because he was a perfect man, because there are none perfect. He was a man after God's own heart because he always wanted to know the ways of God and fought the good fight of faith in bringing his heart into the ways of God. Sometimes bringing your heart into the ways of God feels as easy as carrying a pen. Sometimes bringing your heart over into the ways of God feels like carrying, you know, like a team of donkeys going the opposite direction. But the man, the woman after God's own heart is the person who knows that that's what it means to fight the good fight of faith. Amen. So here we are. David is now king. Saul's selfish reign has ended. David coming on the scene as king is making decisions. And David decides that he wants to bring the Ark of the Covenant to its rightful place. The Ark of the Covenant, if you write down 1 Samuel chapter 4, 5, and 6. We're in 2 Samuel now. But if you write down 1 Samuel 4, 5, and 6, in the days of Eli, before Samuel and before Saul became king, Eli had two sons. They were fleecing the flock. People were bringing offerings. They were saying, look, I know your offerings for the Lord, but whatever, I'm going to stick in my grill fork. And when I put in my grill fork and twist it, whatever part of the filet mignon or whatever part of meat comes off, that's from me and mine. Eli's sons were fleecing the flock, and Eli was not even challenging them. Israel is caught up in religious routine and they go to war with the Philistines. And instead of them saying, hey, here comes a war, here comes a battle, 1 Samuel 4, let's get our hearts right with God. They start resting on past victories, not resting on a heart that's right with God, not resting on a fresh faith, not resting on a devotional life. It's like, let's just rest on past victories and let's rest on religious things. That'd be the equivalent of a person resting in Antioch as a building as opposed to the God who comes in the midst of Antioch. Do you see what I mean? Hey, if I get to church, everything will be right. Yeah, that's true. If when you get to church, you are seeking the Lord and lining your heart up biblically with the Lord of the house. So how easy it is to settle for less and to play religious games. What they decide to do is they're going to war with the Philistines, and they said, let's bring the Ark of the Covenant into the battle. It will fight for us. If you look at the first few verses of 1 Samuel 4, it, not the Lord will fight for us, it will fight for us. What was the Ark of the Covenant? Remember, the Ark of the Covenant is what the piece of furniture that went inside of the Holy of Holies in the Old Testament. It was basically a box overlaid with gold. Inside of that box were the Ten Commandments received from God via Moses. Inside was the broken almond branch that budded supernaturally, speaking of resurrection. Inside of the box was manna, speaking of God's supernatural provision for his people. And on top of the Ark of the Covenant was a lid called the mercy seat, a golden lid. And on top of the golden lid were two angels facing one another. It was based off of Revelation 4 when it says that the angels surround the throne of God and just cry, holy, 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 day and night. See, God's presence, aka his Shekinah glory, would come and dwell almost like a light of an orb of light in the middle of those angels. So now the angels aren't staring at each other, those golden angels. They're staring at the Shekinah glory, which is a picture of heaven with the angels staring at the Lord, the cherubim around the throne. The Ark of the Covenant was essentially God's throne on earth. It was God's presence, and it is where God spoke with his people. Amen? So in the days of Eli, when they're going to fight with the Philistines, can you see how they could fall into the trap of just being religious, trusting in things instead of trusting in the Lord? They said, hey, we're going to fight the Philistines. There's some bad boys and some bad gals. Let's take the Ark of the Covenant with us. The Ark of the Covenant, kind of like taking a rabbit's foot. The Ark of the Covenant, it will fight for us. Well, the Lord is a jealous God, and he won't even have us settling for even resting in even the things of the Lord. He wants us to rest in him. So what happens? The Israelites lose the battle. The Philistines take the Ark of the Covenant. They take it, and they put it in their trophy house. Their trophy house is the temple of their god by the name of Dagon. Dagon was a demonic idol that was like a human body with a fish's tail. And they basically put the Ark of the Covenant in front of Dagon in the temple as a way of saying, our God beat your God. Our statue beat your Ark of the Covenant. Well, chapter 5, they come in the next morning and they see, it says, all knees will bow, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and of things under the earth. They come in, and Dagon's fallen on its face. They're not putting two and two together yet, so they sit Dagon back up, 1 Samuel chapter 5, and they come back in the next morning, Dagon is on its face, its head cut off, and its hands cut off. Then, as the ark is there, all of a sudden, hemorrhoids breaks out all throughout the Philistines. A plague of mice breaks out. And they start realizing, you know something? This ark is wrecking shop. And we need to realize that this is better and bigger and stronger than anything we have here. Let's send it away, right? Go to 1 Samuel 5 real quick, please. 1 Samuel 5. They said, we need to send it back to the Israelites. So they send it back to the Israelites, and when you look at chapter 6, verse 7, they said, this is what we'll do. Make a new cart. Underline that. Here are, please follow me. Please follow me. Please follow me. I'm excited. Here are Philistines, unenlightened, worldly folk who hate the things of God, okay, and who are looking to show how their ways and the ways of the world trump the things of God. Here they are now sending it back because they've been humbled and realizing that there is no God like the true and living God. So they say, when we send it back, look at this, chapter 6, verse 7, put it on a new cart. Put it on a new cart. Like, hey, that makes sense according to worldly thinking. We're humbled. Let's show our respect. Let's hope that we can get this quote-unquote bad luck off of us. Let's put it on a new cart. Nothing old and rickety. Nothing in the new. Put it on a new cart, and let's have some cows take it back. Well, the Israelites are out doing their farm work. The end of chapter 6, they see the ark coming. Can you imagine the joy that God is bringing it back? How merciful, because they realized they were so wrong in taking the ark into a battle without seeking God, trusting in the ark. It's taken away. God in his mercy is bringing it back. And it's not like they wrote the right, I'm sorry letter. Dear Philistines, we're so sorry that they sent the right Israelite ambassadors. We're here with gifts. Can we have the ark? The ark's just coming back with cows. So no one can explain it. No one can take the glory other than God, right? So they take the oxen, sacrifice them on a rock right there, offer it as a gift of surrender to the Lord. But look at verse 19. But the Lord decided to smite the men of Beth Shemesh because they looked into the ark of the Lord and smote of the people 50,000, 70 men. And the people lamented because the Lord had smitten many people with a great slaughter. Here is one thing we must always remember. Though others may make a mistake and may fail to show reverence to the things of God, don't ever let that become contagious in causing you to think that it's just open season of just whatever. In other words, it was commanded that only the Levites could touch the ark, let alone them looking inside of it. Only the Levites were allowed to handle it, and they weren't even to be bear hugging it, touching it. They had golden poles to stick through it, and it was covered with blankets, and they would carry it up on staves. Everyone knew that. But perhaps they're thinking that just because the ark is quote-unquote going through a tough time, that reverence can kind of be thrown out the window, and hey, here I am in the middle of the field, and I'm the one who has it, no one else has it, here it is back, it's been with dirty Philistines, what's the big deal if my hands just look into it? They probably looked all into it anyway, but there is a difference between God's own, who know his laws and have amended his laws, and the world, who has yet to even know, the Bible says, their left hand from their right hand in a spiritual sense, right? So best believe God got his due reverence after that, right? Okay. So it says in verse 21, it says, they sent messengers to the inhabitants of Kirjath-Jearim saying, the Philistines have brought the ark of the Lord, come down and fetch it. They weren't about touching that thing now. Wasn't anybody playing peekaboo or hide and seek or ring around the rosy around the ark now? No one was playing church anymore, right? So they said, you know, you guys, please come get the ark. And the men, chapter 7, verse 1 of Kirjath-Jearim came, fetched the ark of the Lord and brought it to the house of Abinadab in the hill. And they sanctified Eleazar, his son, to keep the ark of the Lord. The ark is here for a number of decades now. Remember, Saul was king before David? David is a man after God's own heart. Saul is a man after his own heart. Saul never had a desire to want to have the ark of the covenant near him. Saul never had a desire to want to get around just the heart of worship and to go as deep as he could. Saul was very content with where he was in his walk. Well, no wonder he ended up becoming a man after his own heart. Because we're either journeying in this walk to want to be more a man or a woman after God's own heart, or you will fall into the trap of saying all the right things, all the right amens, and being in all the right places, but you're really a person after your own heart. It's like me first, and then whatever time is left, the Lord. You're a man or a woman after your own heart. So the ark was taken by the Philistines. The Philistines clearly learned that God is God. They sent it back on a new cart. You need to know that verse though. Chapter 6, verse 7. You're going to see why it's so important. They, as worldly thinkers and no scripture, said, what's the best way to show our humility and our honor? A new cart. Let's go to Lowe's, let's go to the Home Depot of the day, let's get the best wood, the best wheels, WD-40, no creaking going on. That's the best we can do, right? Let's keep reading. So the ark is now in Kirjath-Jearim. God has humbled the Philistines, and God has humbled some Israelites that forgot that God is to be reverenced and his word is to be followed. Now let's go to 2 Samuel chapter 6. David is king. And David the king, truly a man after God's own heart, it's only right that the Ark of the Covenant be brought from the house of Abinadab and be brought into its right place, right? Okay. So David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, about 30,000, okay? David, the king, arose, and with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah, to bring up from there the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who what? Dwells between the cherubim. Look, it was such a big deal that God would dwell in the midst of his people. When God would come down and his Shekinah glory would be between those golden angels on the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, it's like he who the universe can't even contain wants to be in the midst of sinners like us. He who is from eternity past wants to dwell among us. He whose eyes are so pure that he can't even look upon sin wants to be in the midst of sinners. He who spoke and said, let there be light, let there be the toucan, let there be the parrot, let there be the coral reef, let there be the sun, let there be light, wants to come and speak to me. You could not look at the Ark of the Covenant without rehearsing that it was the Ark of the Covenant where the God of all ages, God of every God, would come and be in the middle of the people. How special you would feel. This is the chosen people of God, called to be a light to the world. David says, let's go get that ark and let's bring it to its right place. Why? Because he's a man after God's own heart. But what we're going to see today is he's so sincere. But this is a lesson about when you're so sincere, but you're still not doing it God's way. The church is not lacking. Well, the church does have its insincerity. Even Jesus said, in the church of professing believers, you will have wheat and you will have weeds. Let them both grow together and let the Lord of the harvest separate them. Why? Because some who you think are wheat are actually weeds. And some who are weeds at the last minute may become wheat. Let them both grow together. In the church, there's wheat and weeds. There's sincerity and there's insincerity. But then under the umbrella of sincerity, you have those that are sincere and doing it the right way, and those that are sincere but not following it God's way. And it looks right, and it feels right, and it sounds right, but it's not God's way, so it's only a matter of time before it stumbles. So, let's keep reading. I'm getting ahead of myself a bit, but this is all going to come around full circle. So, it says, verse 3, they set the ark of God upon a new cart. Underline that. Where in the world did they get that idea to put the Ark of the Covenant on a new cart? Where'd they get that idea? The world. Philistines put it on a new cart. We need to be so careful as believers. Look, the world does some stuff. The world gave us the smartphone. Some would be better off if the world never gave them a smartphone. But that's another conversation and another message. The world gave us the smartphone. The world gave us Ford and the automobile. World gives a lot of things, but we need to be careful in not substituting what God decrees for what the world does and for what works for the world. It worked for the world to get the Ark of the Covenant back to where it was supposed to be on a wooden cart. That worked for the world. That's the world's economy. That is not God's economy. That is the God of this world, lowercase g. That is his economy. It worked for the world. God had his own way where things were to be done pertaining to his holy things. Here, they're following the ways of the world. You're like, how do we know? This could be a little bit of a stretch. Well, let's do this. Let's please go to Numbers. Let's go to Numbers, and let's please do Numbers 3. And let's do verses 30 and 31. Numbers 3, verses 30 and 31. And it tells you that the ark was never to be put on a new cart. Didn't matter if it was made from the cedars of Lebanon. Didn't matter if it was drawn by rhinos with diamonds and rubies on their horn. The ark was to be carried by the Levites. Only the Levites were to touch it. Only the Levites were to handle it. God is a God of order. And in God's economy, everything works right when everyone is doing what they are called to do. Right? When wives are doing what wives are called to do, husbands are doing what husbands are called to do. Children are doing what children are called to do. Pastors are doing what pastors are called to do. A congregation is doing what a congregation is called to do. Do you know what the Bible has for you as a congregation? We live in a day where wives don't really know what the Bible says wives are supposed to do because wives are so busy studying what the husbands are supposed to do. Husbands don't really know what husbands are supposed to do, but they got memorized everything the wife is supposed to do. Right? Sent a husband on a conference. He came back with what? Just memorizing, having memorized all of what the wife is supposed to be doing. Right? A day where the congregation isn't even studying the scriptures to say, what's the role of a congregation? How does a congregation play a role in blessing a church, protecting a church, and growing a church? No, they just want to study all the ways of what a pastor is supposed to do. All of us have what we are to do, and we're each to know that. The Levites were charged with carrying the ark. Not anybody's new cart. Look at Numbers 3, verses 30 and 31. And it says, and the chief of the house of the father of the families of the Kohathites, they were among the Levites, will be Elazaphan and or the son of Uzziel. Their charge will be the ark and the table and the candlestick and the altars and the vessels of the sanctuary wherewith they minister and the hanging and all the service thereof. And it goes on to speak of them moving it, how they were to use golden poles to stick it through the ark, and they were to carry it like that. No opening it up, no peeking inside, no handling it, no nothing. Even there was reverence. So already there's a foundational problem. David has the right desire. He is a man after God's own heart. It is beautiful that he wants the Ark of the Covenant representing the presence of God right where it is supposed to be, in the center of worship, and no longer in the house of Abinadab. He has got the right heart. But foundationally, he is going about it the wrong way. How many things are those in our lives where we can have a desire, but the foundation of that desire is off? Foundationally, we're going about it the wrong way. There's a mission, there's a feeling, there's something there, but foundationally, we're going about it the wrong way. This is here to teach us that big doors swing on small hinges, and that no matter how good it looks, no matter how good it feels, and no matter how good the worship music is going on in the midst of it, if the foundation is wrong and against the clear teaching of Scripture, it is only a matter of time before the oxen stumble. So let's keep reading. So he wants the ark to come. Verse 3, they set the ark upon a new cart. Two things he's doing wrong. One, it says the Levites were supposed to handle it. He's got men from Judah handling it. But he could justify it. And doesn't it get dangerous when we want to justify? Well, Judah in the Hebrew means praise. We're going to praise God while we're bringing it. So why not have people from the tribe that means praise carrying the ark? We do weird things with the word of God when we want to justify some stuff, right? So he's got the wrong people leading it, and it's on the wrong thing. It's on a cart. So verse 3, they put it on a new cart, which he borrowed from the world, and they brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah, and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark of God. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments, fir wood and harps, psalteries and timbrels, cornets and cymbals. Can you imagine? He had the best of the best instruments. Can you imagine the shine put on those instruments? Can you imagine how those worship leaders were leading? And were they all doing the same step? And was it something like this? Or was it two up? And was it two back? Or what in the world? But you better believe whatever it was, it looked good. It looked good. Can you write sincerity? You get the picture that there is one thing you would say if you saw this was sincerity, hard work. But Paul says to the Galatian Christians who fell into the lie that they needed to circumcise themselves in order for God to love them more, Paul said, have you suffered so many things in vain? If it was all in vain, what about when all the sincerity, all the hard work, all of the effort, And the Lord says it was all in vain. Oh yeah, there was suffering. Oh yeah, someone got blisters shining that stuff. Someone pulled an all-nighter. People were practicing. Lots of hard work. Someone got splinters. Someone banged their finger when they made the new cart. Maybe someone cut themselves and had to get stitches or whatever it is. But have you suffered so many things in vain if it was all done in vain? Because it's not being done God's way. Our sincerity does not bully God into blessing us. If the foundation is not right, our sincerity is not going to bully him, manipulate him, or win him over to blessing us. If the foundation is off, the foundation is off, and God will wait. A day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years is like a day. He will wait until you come to realize that the foundation needs to be fixed. And you can keep going at it and going at it. You can't wear him out. You could wear out your teacher in grammar school. You could wear out, you know, mom or dad, hold your breath till you turn blue. Sit upstairs and cry crocodile tears until they shorten your punishment by 98%. Doesn't work with the Lord because he loves us too much to let us walk in any type of compromise or even think that compromise equals blessing. So they are going. Verse 5, David and all of the house played. Verse 6, and when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah, look at this, put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it because the oxen shook it. Well, would you please go to 1 Chronicles 13:9? Keep your finger there, but go 3 books to the right. Please go to 1 Chronicles 13:9. 1 Chronicles 13:9 is telling you that the reason the ark shook, is because the oxen shook it. The reason the oxen shook it is because the oxen stumbled. You see, how good do you think this sounded, by the way? Would you please look at 1 Chronicles 13:8? David and all of Israel played before God with all their might, with singing and harps, with psalteries, with timbrels, cymbals and trumpets. Somebody would have called this a revival. People would have shouted to others and said, there's a revival going on, but look at this, it's not a revival. It's revved up human emotion, and God is not there. And verse 9, when they came to the threshing floor of Chidon, Uzzah put forth his hand to hold the ark because what? The oxen stumbled. Just so you know, you have the books of Samuel and Kings. And then you ever notice that Chronicles seems like it's just rehearsing the same exact stories? What Chronicles is doing is giving you a spiritual behind the scenes of what really happened. So Samuel and Kings is saying, this happened, this happened, this happened. Chronicle comes behind the scenes and says, because of this. Because of this, because of this. It's giving you the spiritual commentary of what's going on behind the curtain. It says here the oxen stumbled, and basically in the Greek it says they were in a tense state. The oxen were tense, so they ended up stumbling. When God's spirit and his blessing is not upon the work, the peace of God is not there. The stumbling is only bound to come. The tension is there. So what happens is the oxen stumbled, the ark shook, and Uzzah goes and puts his hand there to steady the ark. He thinks he's doing the right thing. He also makes the mistake of thinking that his hand, his sinful hand, is cleaner than the dirt on the ground. Look at that. R.C. Sproul once said that, and 10+ years ago, I heard that and never forgot that. So it says in verse 7 that the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him right there for his error, and he died by the ark of God. Everyone knew the word of God here. It said that for every Old Testament picture, there's a New Testament principle. We're looking at an Old Testament picture. What are some New Testament principles that come here? Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. No matter how it looks, no matter how it sounds, God's not mocked. He's not mocked, and he won't be mocked. 2, James 1, verse 27. be doers of the word and not just hearers only. Because a person who just hears the word and doesn't do it is like a person who looks in the mirror in the morning, sees everything that needs fixing on their face from a night of REM sleep, looks at it, and then walks away and doesn't do anything about it. 1 Timothy 4:15, it says, do everything, obey God's word fully, and don't do anything halfway or by partiality. And isn't it true that in our lives we have to watch against doing things by partiality? Some people go to the gym, and you know there's a reason they have the whole workout done in a certain way at the gym. It's called a circuit. It's designed to work every muscle because it's all about body balance. But there are those that go to the gym, and you like working arms, and you hate working legs. So you skip all of the circuit, and you do only arms, and now you look like the lobster on SpongeBob, you know what I mean? All arms and no legs. Sorry, my kids watch cartoons, right? You get my point, though. The point is that all of us have stuff that we enjoy obeying, right? Oh, wow, you know, laying down my life for the person on Skid Row and ready to be the Good Samaritan. I love that. But then what about the scriptures on forgiveness? Oh, well, you know, I ain't Jesus. How many believers are stuck in their walk by the alibi of, well, I ain't Jesus? First off, everyone knows you're not Jesus. All the angels in heaven, the entire demonic realm, everyone you know and Jesus knows you ain't Jesus, okay? So when you say that, everyone knows that. But we are called to be ye perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. So the scripture's saying, do nothing by partiality. Here, God is not mocked. David knew the right rule. Why? Because in Deuteronomy 17, it says that when a king became king, the first thing he had to do was go to the Levites, get a copy of the Bible, sit down, and copy it by hand and carry it with him all the time. The king had his own Bible. He knew it. And he decided to follow a little bit of the ways of the world. Now let's do a new cart instead of the Levites. God is not mocked. Oh, the men of Beth Shemesh fell over dead. You know, will God do that twice? Will lightning strike in the same place? God is not mocked. And he learned not to do anything by partiality. So let's keep reading. Uzzah is now dead next to the ark of God. The music stops. Music stops. Quote unquote, revival's over. And they're realizing it wasn't even a revival. And David was displeased. Look at this, verse 8. Isn't it interesting how God allows things to happen just so we could see where our heart is? David was displeased, verse 8. You know what the Hebrew is? He was grieved and offended. David was offended. Look at that. It's not even like Uzzah fell and the man after God's own heart was like, oh, say no more. As soon as I saw him touch it, I knew the Levite should have been doing it. As soon as the oxen stumbled, I knew, you know, that it should have been Levites carrying it. The new cart thing, as soon as I saw those oxen stumble, I hated that cart. No, it says that he's in a place that's not good right now. He's grieved and he's offended. David needs to learn a big lesson right here. David, you are the king. David, you are a man after God's own heart. But David, it's not about you. He's grieved and offended. Remember when John the Baptist was in jail? And I imagine the first week, John the Baptist was just counting down the days of when Jesus was going to bust the doors open. Guards offering him food. I won't be here long. I won't be around. No, thank you. Right? Then all of a sudden, it's getting really close, and he can hear the guillotine knife being sharpened. He sends some messengers to Jesus. Are you really the Messiah? Or should we look for another? Jesus said, go and tell him that the blind are receiving sight and the crippled are walking. He basically took him to the scriptures. Look at that. Whenever you're in doubt or whatever you're going through, even Jesus directs us to the scriptures. Tell him to read Isaiah 35. I am fulfilling the scriptures. I am the Messiah. And then he says this, blessed is he who's not offended in me. What he says in the Greek is, blessed is he who's not offended in the way I do what I do. Do you get offended in the way God does what he does? Or do you have a heart like Job, where in the middle of whatever, you just simply fall down and worship? Or do you get grieved and offended, fold your arms, and you blame a human being, but it's really not a human being. It's just that you don't like the way God does what he does. So David's displeased because the Lord made a breach upon Uzzah. He called the name of the place Perez Uzzah, a breach on Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how will the ark of the Lord come to me? Isn't it interesting that once our heart's out of whack, we're grieved, we're offended, we can have a way of forgetting all Bible wisdom. What do you mean, how shall the ark come to me? You copied Deuteronomy 17. You copied Numbers chapter 3. The ark comes by the Levites, minus ox, minus new cart, and minus anyone's hands on it. But it's funny how everyone can just start drawing a blank. Now do you see why the Bible says it's so important to guard your heart? Because when your heart's not right, your biblical thinking's not right. When your heart's not right, even how to apply scripture right's not right. Jesus said, the light of the body is the eye. If your eye is single, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye has a squint, whether you're looking at God, you know how does it look people with a squint? From Jersey, it was all about the squint, right? New York, the squint. You know what I mean? It's just that look. Like the squint. It's like what it means in the Greek is if your eye is evil, meaning if your eye is seeing double, you know you can actually do it to the point where you can make it look like there's two people in front of you, right? Yeah. If you were bored in school, you would do that with your eyes and make it be two teachers. Teachers are like, you're so bored. She's like, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, there's two of you right now, you know? That's what it means in the Sermon on the Mount. If your eye is single, your whole body's full of light. But if your eye is evil, in the Greek, if your eye is a squint, and you're seeing double, your body will be full of darkness and how quick that darkness consumes you. We have to stop right here because the Bible's talking about the heart. We know the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. Is your eye single right now? Or is your eye with a squint towards God, towards man? Bible says you better watch it because that darkness will cover you faster than poison ivy, faster than poison oak, and faster than an allergic food reaction. He said, how great is that darkness becomes. But you know how we do. We're like, oh, I can control this. I've controlled this kind of darkness since I was a kid. And that thing gets you. So David draws a blank. How will I get the ark? David's wrapped up in his situation right now. He's not repented yet. The good news is he always shows himself to be a man after God's own heart. He always comes around. That's what makes him a man after God's own heart. Not that he never made mistakes. He made big mistakes, huge mistakes that had huge implications. It's not that he was perfect. It's not that he never went into a funk. It's that the man always came around at the end. By the end of the movie, the man came around. Every movie involving David had a happy ending because the man always came around. That's what makes David a man after God's own heart. Do you want to be that man, that woman that, oh yeah, things have, blah, blah, blah. You always come around. Husband going home to the wife, yo, never mind what you did wrong. I'm the jerk, I'm owning it all. I got to be like Jesus. That's a man after God's own heart. The wife, never mind your underwear on the floor and all the different things. It's all about me glorifying the Lord through obeying the word. You are my spiritual head. That's all it's about. The children, on the job, right? I've been saying, you can't tell your boss you've been saying stuff about him, but look, you got a new employee. I just want you to know that. You see what I'm saying? Are you willing to be that one? You just always come around. Been in church for years, not served, not wanted to serve. All of a sudden, like, you know what, Lord? Yes, I'm in the game. Whatever they want me to do. Before I was waiting, it had to be this, this, that. Now it's just like, where's the mop? Where's the nearest toilet? Thank you very much. I'll be in the bathroom. You just come around. We want to be the one that no matter what, we just come around. We come around. We come around. Look, Jesus could be coming back any moment. Time to come around in every category. Hallelujah. Come around in every category with repentance, with accountability to finish well. So, David was afraid. David, verse 10, look at this, would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him in the city of David. He was like, look, now he's acting all scared. I'm not bringing the ark into the city of David. You know, I'm not doing this anymore. Why? He's grieved and offended. His heart's not right. Still in the religious circle, still using spiritual language, but his heart's not right, and you can see it. He's despairing. He has no idea how to apply Bible all of a sudden, but he's been amen in Bible for years. He's written Psalms. Now all of a sudden he has no idea how to apply Scripture, acting like he's despairing, acting like there's no way out. Yeah, I don't want it to come here. I mean, he's actually acting like a brat. Is there in any of us a bratty heart? The church, don't think it's just David. The church has brats. Brats. Good-sounding brats. Bible-quoting brats. But brats. Brats. And leadership can't go around calling people brats. You just pray for them. You know, because you also know that apart from the grace of God, there's a brat waiting to bust out of you. You know what I mean? David's acting like a brat. And then look at this. So verse 11, the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom. Because verse 10, he has it go to the house of Obed-Edom. So it's like, no, it's not coming here to the city of David. It's going to Obed-Edom's house. He's sticking it in someone's house. He's a little angry with God. I'm going to put the ark in a house. It was in a house for so many decades. Go back to a house. We do weird things when we're grieved and offended. I hope this story is just showing why it's so important to guard our hearts and guard our hearts and guard our hearts. A little bit of attitude is all you need. Becomes a big attitude. A little bit of looking at the squint. A little bit of sucking of the teeth. A little bit of arms folded. A little bit of now what? A little bit of I tried so hard. Now so that's what happens when I try hard. I'll never try again. And not willing to say, yeah, well, you tried hard. But no matter how hard you try, if it goes against Scripture, the oxen are going to stumble. That applies to relationships. That applies to ministry. That applies to work. No matter how hard you work on that thing, the job that the Lord doesn't have for you, the ministry, whatever it is, the church home that you are not supposed to be. You're supposed to be another church home. You're supposed to be the one you left from. I mean, let's talk about that for a minute. Do we all believe you're supposed to live in a certain neighborhood until God says so? You just move and you don't check in with God? Right? Do we all believe you're supposed to be at the job God wants you at? You hear people saying, my job is tough, but have you looked for a new job? No, God hasn't spoken to me about leaving the job yet. Do people apply the same thing to their local church? No, Joshua Harris had to write a book called Stop Dating the Church because people just easily, well, I'll just change churches. He said there was a story of a man on an island. He was abandoned on an island, right? They went to rescue him, and there were three huts there. They said, you're the only one here, right? It's not three of you? It's just you? No, it's just me. You're the only one abandoned on this island. Only just me abandoned on this island. Just Gilligan minus the rest of the crew. Just me. Well, then why three huts? He goes, well, the first one is my house. Well, what's the second one? The second one is my house of worship. What's the third one? Third one, that's my old church. I don't go there anymore. So David is feeling a certain way now, and David sends the ark to the house of Obed-Edom. And if an artist were to make a drawing, this is how I see David right now. Not just arms folded, but this on the side. Okay? Whatever it is. Every culture has its different body language to show that they are frustrated, that they're grieved, that they're offended, that they're in a funk, that they have an attitude, and they want everyone to know it, even God. But here's the thing. Would you write this down? First thing, write down this. No matter how good it looks, no matter how good it feels, no matter how good it sounds, and no matter how many people are involved, if it's not on a biblical foundation, the oxen will stumble. No matter how good it looks, no matter how good it feels, no matter how good it sounds, no matter how many people are involved, if it is on a non-biblical foundation, the oxen will stumble. It's just a matter of not if, when, point one. Point two, when the oxen stumble, it's not about you. It is not about you. Think of as teenagers, how many times an adult, someone had to say, it's not about you. Think about maybe in high school, I don't know, somewhere, some arena. You remember, because you don't forget it when someone says that to you. You know, it gets you. It's not about you. It's like, whoa, the truth is, it's not about us. Yes, there's things going on and things churn. The heart is never lacking an emotion, but it's about God being glorified. It's not about us. It's about Him being glorified. Point three. Ready? It's never too late. It's never too late to do it the right way. And that's where the story ends. It's never too late to do it the right way. Look at this. He goes on. It's in the house of Obed-Edom. But wait, you would think, this is what you would think. You would think, that, and this is what we think. If we're grieved and offended, and our arms are folded, and we got an ought and a this and a that, we can sometimes feel like the whole kingdom of God's got to stop. Well, I'm mad. I ain't going to church. And then we'd almost expect, like, to get the report, like, yeah, well, church wasn't blessed because you weren't there. Please come back. See, point two, it's not about you. I'm leaving. Oh, man, since that departure, everything stopped. David's way at St. Obadiah's garage till I figure stuff out. It's not about us. And add point, if point one is no matter how good it looks, no matter how good it feels, no matter how good it sounds, no matter how many people are involved, if the foundation is wrong, the oxen will stumble. If point two is it's not about you, point three is the kingdom will go on without you. Oh, it will. Oh, it will. Without me, without y'all, without any kingdom will go on just fine. Maybe better without me. That's the attitude we all have to have. The most humble place you could be is to say, not only will the work of God continue without me, but it might even get better without me. Because I'm the biggest hindrance I personally know. And everyone should feel the same way. It does well to rehearse that with yourself. Verse 12, David gets news, and the news is, hey, King David, the Lord is blessing the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertains to him because the ark of God. Like, you'd think it'd be like Obed-Edom wouldn't get blessed. David's arms are folded. Everyone's catering. What's wrong? What's wrong, David? It's all about David. David gets word like, yo, David, your arms are folded and you want to sit yourself in time out. Yo, Obed-Edom's getting rocked. Obed-Edom's getting his whole house is getting their socks blessed. Their sandals are getting blessed off over there. The show goes on without us. When we want to sit off and have a funk or sit off in bitterness or whatever or a fog or a this or a whatever and, you know, like the little kid, I'm leaving and I'm taking my toys with me or whatever, the show will go on. God's work will continue without us. He loves using us, wants to have us a part of it. What father doesn't want all of his children in the project? No father wants one kid upstairs sulking. But if that kid insists on sulking, the work will go on. The yard work will go on. The endeavor will go on. So David, what did he do? He went and he brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom back to the city of David with gladness. Underline gladness. That's the very opposite of him being displeased in verse 8. Verse 8, he is grieved and offended. Here in this verse, gladness. There he is, the man after God's own heart. It says, a righteous man falls 7 times, but the Lord lifts him up. Oh, yeah, he was in a fog. He was in a funk. But guess what? He cooperated with the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, it could have went another way. He could have gotten more hardened when he heard Obed-Edom getting blessed. He could have went from holding his arms to starting to rip out Obed-Edom's back. Well, you know Obed-Edom, right? Well, he's getting blessed. Well, you really know Obed-Edom? Let me tell you about Obed-Edom. I mean, it could have went a whole other direction, more angry. But he decides, I got 2 choices. I could sit here and let it be all about me. Or you know what? I could jump into the blessings. I could dive into the pool of blessings because while I'm out here all dry, people are swimming laps in blessings. Know what? I got a choice. I'm a man after God's own heart. What does God's heart want? What glorifies God? Hey, make room in the pool of blessing. King David is back. I'm diving in too. Let's all swim and give God some praise. Amen? Praise God. That's what we should see. It could be so abstract when we hear it shared. He's a man after God's own heart. He's a man after God's own heart. What does that mean? The scriptures show you what it is. The man came around, right? 3 cheers for David cooperating with the Holy Ghost. Amen? Because it says in the scriptures, and he even wrote this, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Meaning when I get in a funk, when my thinking gets wrong, goodness and mercy will track me down. It's just our job to cooperate with that goodness and mercy when they do track us down. Some people want to feel their way so bad, goodness and mercy come, they're kicking away goodness and mercy. Because you can get into a place where you actually start making an idol out of your bad feelings, an idol out of your negative feelings. You can become codependent on your negative feelings and develop a very sick relationship with negative ways of thinking. Now do you see why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4 and 5, use the Holy Spirit to take captive dangerous thoughts, put them in a chokehold and kill them, bringing into every thought, bringing it into captivity to the obedience of Jesus Christ. It's in the thought life. The mind is a dangerous place, but the Holy Spirit has come to make the mind and the heart like the Garden of Eden again. But it takes work. Adam was put in the garden to dress it and to keep it. Do you dress and keep? Oh yeah, he was there to dress and keep the Garden of Eden, but the real garden he was supposed to be cultivating and beautifying was the garden of his heart. The mind is a dangerous place, but the Holy Spirit is here to make it into the Garden of Eden again. But it requires work and cultivation and landscaping. So David went and brought it back with gladness. And it was so that when they brought it back with gladness, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. David danced before the Lord, look at this, with all his might. Isn't there something about repenting and coming back and how grace is more amazing? You appreciate the blood all the more. You're all the more humble. Jesus looks more wonderful. Even the word Savior sounds more beautiful than ever. He's dancing. He was dancing before. Now it says he's dancing with all his might. And it says David was even girded with a linen ephod. He's taking worship more seriously now. He's realizing it's not just praise music, it's worship. Verse 16, as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, saw David through a window, and she saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord. I mean, what was he doing? What dances was he doing? I'm not going to try and imitate it. It's not going to go there, but what was he doing? And it says that she despised him in her heart. There's someone not guarding their heart. Here's a person choosing blessing, rejoicing in the blessing, dancing with all of his heart in the blessing, and here's someone looking on and jealous, angry, bothered that he is enjoying the blessings. But you know, First Chronicles comes back in and tells us again that though David returned, look at First Chronicles 15. This time David did it the right way. It wasn't oxen, it wasn't a cart. He goes back to the scriptures. You guys, it's always about going to the scriptures. Not 98% scripture and a new cart. Not 97% scripture and a new cart and Judah instead of Levites. All scripture, not doing anything by partiality. Would you write this down? Partial obedience is disobedience. They're like, well, he's obeying the Lord. It's partially obeying, but there's more obedience than disobedience here. Partial obedience is disobedience. We're either following the scriptures to the jot and the tittle, or we're not. Jesus said, until heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or tittle. That's the Hebrew way of saying not one dot of the I or one cross of the T. We are most blessed when we follow what the scriptures say. Look, 1 Chronicles 15. The priests and the Levites sanctified themselves to bring up the ark. Oh, now he's going directly by the word. Verse 15, the children of the Levites bear the ark of God on their shoulders with the staves. No more Philistines and doing it the world's way on a new cart. Verse 26, it came to pass when God helped the Levites that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, they offered 7 bullocks and 7 rams. What does that speak of? That speaks of the whole burnt offering in Leviticus 1. And what that speaks of in Leviticus 1, when you brought the whole burnt offering, what it spoke of is, I'm taking this 2,000-pound animal and I'm going to throw it up on the altar. That represents all of me, all my baggage, all my stuff. I'm just laying it all out to you, Lord. I might be all crazy and whatever, but I'm yours and I give everything to you. But before you did that, you were to cut it in pieces. You were to cut it open. You were to take the guts out, the insides, and wash the guts with water first. Water represents the word of God. The guts represents our insides. That said, Lord, not only am I dedicating all of myself to you, but I'm examining. I'm giving you my motives, my thought life, my attitude. I'm examining everything inside me with water, because I'm not just going to, just the act of worship, like act like it somehow puts you in a trance. You want truth in the inward parts. You don't just want a song that hits the right notes. You don't just want tears and dancing and whatever, you know, whatever. You want truth in the inward parts. Here's water. I'm washing the intestines out with water. Meaning, I'm taking your word and I'm going all up in myself. And whatever doesn't line up with your word, I'm washing that out. That's the offering God wanted. That's what David's doing now. He's realizing this is to be done biblically. This is to be done with self-examination. And I'm to be watchful for my heart. I'm to be watchful for thinking that the kingdom needs me. I'm to be watchful for thinking I'm doing God a favor. I'm to be watchful for thinking that I am the hero, that I'm the lowercase m Messiah. That in a day where everyone's doing so much wrong, that even the person who partially obeys is still head and shoulders above the rest. God is God. And God wants to bless us. So, one, no matter how good it looks, no matter how good it feels, no matter how good it sounds, no matter how many people are involved, if the foundation is wrong, the oxen will stumble. There will be pain. It says the way of the transgressor is hard. The only thing harder than doing God's will is going against God's will. 1 Timothy 4:15, do nothing by partiality. Partial obedience is still disobedience. That's point one. Point two. It's not about us. It's not about us. We're offended, we're hurt. Yes, there's a place for sharing that. The Bible lists that. But it's not about us. It's about the kingdom of God and us dying daily and seeking his glory. Two or three, the kingdom work will go on without us. The blessings will go on without us. The show will go on without us. And that's something we need to let hit right between the eyes till we all really believe that. Because there's some believers that really do think that if they left, somehow the there's a certain stock in blessing that's going to go out with them. David learned that when he finds out that Obed-Edom's garage is now the most blessed piece of real estate on planet Earth. Four, it's never too late to do it right. And to really experience worship and devotion and surrender and sacrifice and blessing in a whole new way. Amen? Amen. So the questions for us are, what are the wooden carts in our lives? What are the wooden carts in our lives? Looks good. Looks clean. You put a lot of hard work into it. But they're wooden carts. What are the wooden carts in our lives? What ways are we imitating the world? God says it must be through prayer, humility, and a crying out for the Holy Spirit. But we want to do it through hard work and do it our own way. That's a wooden cart. God says we're to operate in community, together. And there's an order in the church, and everyone is safest when they operate in God's prescribed order. But we decide that we know a little bit, and do it our own way. That's a wooden cart. It's not a matter of if the oxen will stumble, it's just when the oxen are going to stumble. I've been pastoring for over 15 years. You see a lot when you pastor for over 15 years. A lot of experience comes with that. What are the wooden carts in our marriages? Maybe you're the spouse, do stuff wrong. And you can be counted on to faithfully come in the door with gifts. But that's what the world does. We come in with gifts, but before the gifts, we come in with words, repentance, humility. Tell me about me. How could I be better at what I do? I want to be more like Jesus to you, right? And raising our kids. We could let video games and smartphones raise them. Oh, there's youth pastors here, right? Yeah, they teach my kid the word. Letting someone else raise your kids. That's a wooden cart. It's not a matter of if the oxen will stumble, it's when the oxen will stumble. Right? God has designed it. that we get together, we fellowship. The church is providing the means for married couples to get together, for men to get together. Last Thursday night, one of the most amazing men's groups we've ever had here. We sat around, 15 men. We talked about what does it mean to be a man. And if a little boy came up to you, your son, your nephew, and said, excuse me, or a mentee, excuse me, what's it mean to be a man? What's the Bible say a man is? Would you be able to answer him in under one sentence?
Well, what a man is a man, you know, man goes back to Genesis because you have man. He made man and then man and then man and then man and then, you know, and that's it, basically. And a man does this and a man does that and a man does that.
And then we talked about how we could so easily in the church settle for the cultural, religious definition of a man. That's still the provider, still the one that makes everyone feel safe, still the little kids want to give a high five to, but it's still not the spiritual man that embraces weakness and says, in my weakness, he is strong, and that is on the road of getting filled with the Holy Spirit. Because the culturally religious man, though viewed by many and a good role model and a man that you'd want to have over for dinner, could still be the man that refuses to take the kind of surrender and take the type of humility that equals getting filled with the Holy Spirit. So we had a good talk on manhood. God is providing that place, but if someone has the time to come to that but doesn't want to come to that and says, well, you know, man, I can YouTube manhood and watch a good YouTube video. But meanwhile, you have the means to come here. The women got together and talked about Mary and Elizabeth, right? Both pregnant, but no distrust, no competition, no one's better, no one-upmanship, no one trying to be more pregnant or more sexy while they're pregnant than the other one. Both just praising one another, praising God's work in one another, and encouraging one another. Oh, it was rich Thursday night. It was rich. My point is this: if growth is what we want, and we want to be able to be a man or a woman after God's own heart, then we have to start really inclining our heart to what does God require of me? I don't throw this stuff out to you to make you start coming up and saying, well, okay, I got 2 sick days left for the next 5 years. I'm going to use those sick days to come here. Otherwise, I'm not going to be blessed. No, all I'm just saying is just seek God for what he requires of you. And just beware of in your own personal walk when we're substituting wooden carts for what God has in any way, shape, or form. God says, pray, seek me early. We say, I'm feeling pretty good on my own. Wooden cart. God says, Psalms 1, the man that meditates in God's word day and night is like a tree planted by rivers of water that will bloom and blossom. Everything he does will prosper. It says basically you will have a spiritual Midas touch. What you touch will turn to gold. But the person says, no. But I see books in Barnes & Noble on how to be the effective man, how to be the likable man, 10 steps of being awesome, 10 steps of your neighbors thinking you're awesome, and that's going to be what I read to be awesome. It's your wooden cart. Gets deep. Requires us to think about this, doesn't it? Proverbs 31 lists a virtuous woman. But someone's like, yeah, but you know, virtuous women don't get good guys. I'm going to put on a little bit of. That's how I'm going to get my man. Then I'll bring him the Bible. But I'm going to catch him with this type stuff. I'm going to catch him with how what happens when the drum beat drops. And when he sees the likes of me, he ain't seen what I do on a dance floor. Then I'll show him the Bible. That's a wooden cart. We can go on and on, but look, the reason we can all laugh is we're all sinners. Sinners saved by an awesome God. Sinners saved by an awesome God. All of us tried that two-step on the dance floor. And some of you just fantasized about it because you can't dance or envied the one that could, but everyone's guilty in this room. Everyone's imagined the two-step in the middle of the dance floor to catch something, someone, whatever. But the beautiful thing is this, it's always time to come around. Who's ready to come around? God has recipes for growth. He has recipes for blessings and growth. Coming to church, getting fed by the word of God. Well, I could read the Bible at home and get blessed. Yeah, you can. But Ephesians 4 tells me that there's a special way God speaks to his people here that cannot be reproduced at home. Bible also tells me that there's a way you can meet with him alone at home that also can't be reproduced here. A just balance is a delight to the Lord, but a false balance is an abomination. He hates a false balance. What do we want to do? Right? I forgive that person, I just don't want to see him. That's a wooden cart. 1 John 2 says, if you hate your brother, you walk in darkness and you can't even see where you're walking. It gets deep, but it's also very simple too. That's why the youngest person in this room or the person who's the youngest in Christ can amen all of it. It's so deep, but it's so simple too. Amen? Let's go hard for Jesus. Let's pray for one another. And let's just, right now, let's have the worship team come up. Is there anyone here and you just want to finish well? Maybe you're that person, the Bible found, you're the one with the arms folded, grieved and offended. You just can't get over how someone did you or how God did you or some things turned out the way you don't like. Your arms are folded. But you find out that the kingdom of God is doing just great. Blessings are still falling out. Holy Spirit's still falling on people left and right. It's never too late to exchange all of those funky feelings for gladness. But what's not included in here that you know happened, David repented of some stuff, and David embraced some right stuff. Amen? 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 Isn't the Word of God so beautiful, so precious? Is it not? Meets us all right where we are. Amen? Praise God indeed. Father, we thank you for this time together. We're asking you now to bless us. And Lord, while you've located every one of us through this teaching, would you let us build a fence? We build a fence to keep out vermin from our yards. Build a fence to keep out unwanted dogs from our yards. Can this message today, can we build a fence around our hearts? And it be a message we don't forget that big doors swing on small hinges. It's just little acts of disobedience, little compromises that can cause the whole system so much problem. Would you show us areas where we're compromising and lead us into repentance? Things that we don't think's a big deal. One wooden cart, one oxen. Show us the things that we've been thinking. We made a habit of thinking it's not a big deal. But maybe there's a reason why we've been missing out on blessings. Because it is a big deal. Show us. Show us, Lord. Lord, would you receive this afternoon's offering as well? And thank you that of all you give to us, we can give to you. Would you receive this as worship as well? And Lord God, we love the gospel. We love the gospel. We love the gospel that we can be in any location and you meet us with love and goodness and an invitation to behold the Lamb slain for all of our weirdness, iniquity, and wickedness. And we can take a spiritual shower and celebrate being forgiven and completely cleansed by the blood of Jesus, no matter what. Bless this time. Receive this afternoon's offering from us as worship as well. In Jesus' name, amen.